For the next 1 hour, can I request you all to drop all your corporate identities about companies you represent, and let's just have a straight talk, right? Just a person-to-person conversation about the nuances of D&I, the challenges we face, and without the political correctness. Are you up for it? Sure? Okay, perfect. Well, it's offensive to have a gay man come and talk about straight talk. So we'll start with the first thing. We all know D&I is good for business. There's a lot of research about it, about more diverse the boards are, more women, more people of color, LGBT, PWD, all kinds of things we talk about. There's data about it. Yes? Yes? Not convinced, audience. There is data about it. Do we agree with that? Yes. But we also struggle with that. While we understand that it's good for business, we struggle with the representation of various URMs at the workplace. Why is that? I think this is your cue for the first question. On Slido, please fill in the poll. So this is supposed to be interactive through Slidos. If you have a question, you can either put in Slido, just ask, yeah? Yeah. And if you think there are more options to that, feel free to just shout out whatever that option is. What is your biggest hurdle in the journey of D&I? Yep. Thank you. So we'd start with Deepa with that. Why? Why do we struggle?
Okay. I hope everyone can hear me. Cool. So so this is diversity dilemmas, right? So I just want to ask, just raise your hands. How many of you are in this room with a diversity dilemma? Just raise your hand. Whatever dilemma that could be. Okay. And I hope, you know, in a corporate organization, we all consider ourselves as leaders. Am I right? We got our voices, we got our opinions, and we always consider to be leaders. That's how you grow within the organization, right? And with the poll saying lack of awareness, that's so true, right? I think when it comes to diversity and when it comes to nuances of diversity, I think over the period of time, we have seen that lack of awareness was the first plunge for a solution or an inclusion to sprout, right? So I saw a lot of people having diversity dilemmas here. Can someone tell me what is a dilemma that you have? So probably we could see if we have a solution to it.
Yeah, some of the others who have felt other instead of lack of awareness and leadership buy-in, if someone can share one dilemma. Can we have the mic there, please? Or you can just shout out, ma'am, if that's okay.
Other types of diversity is also important. We're a clinical research company, so in healthcare, and it's very difficult to get people to understand and then, you know, push down the required leadership to get things done. Convincing is probably the biggest dilemma we have.
Convincing.
Yeah, that's a, yes. So I think when it comes to gender, over the past, I think, 2 decades, you know, do you all think we've really moved the gender needle? We have, right? And we can definitely take a good, credible amount of appreciation in terms of putting in processes, in terms of enabling women within our workforces, enabling leaders within our workforces. And I think we've moved the needle way far, right? But what about the other diversities, right? So, you know, when it comes to, say, people with disabilities, okay? So this agenda, you know, as far as I know, is around a period of a decade now, right, or 10 years now. So when I wanted to just join, right, an organization 10 years back, it was a struggle of 3 years to getting into, you know, getting a job, basically, right? And the only thing that I could do and my disability would never interfere was actually building my career or actually contributing to my career, right? I was pretty sure that I had no dilemmas there. Then I knew I could stand and I could work and I could build my career, and I could, you know, then foresee how to build an organization as well. That's the least of dilemmas that I had. But the dilemmas that around me was just dilemmas. How would she perform? How would she come in? How would she do it? Now today, you know, I have taken the conversation way ahead in terms of organization looking into how do they want to include people with disabilities. Or now we are looking into the charter of LGBT, right? I think lack of awareness is a very critical thing here. So when it comes to dilemmas and when it comes to, say, if you go deeper into, say, people with disabilities, I don't think we all, right, in this room have had a chance, you know, earlier in our life or in our careers or even in our schoolings, right, to have a friend or a close, you know, relative or someone who had a disability, right? Some of us are fortunate enough to have someone like that, but most of us probably they had a far relative we didn't kind of look into. But when we started the diversities, when it comes to disability, I think we looked into that specs. We quickly got connected. We knew that some relative there had a disability and it was probably a family or a friend. We quickly saw how skillful they were, right? How could we bring them on board into the organization? So I think awareness brings a lot of steadiness within diversity. You kind of build a very strong focus base when you have awareness. So like the Paul says, I think we got to create more of awareness channels around us and to be very candid in bringing stories of different diversities. And today, throughout the day, I think we have had some amazing conversations around that. Real people talking the real deal.
So moving on, when we talk about URM representation, which is underrepresented minority, there's always this debate, should we hire people first and then figure out ways to go about it? Or, and at that time, there's a debate whether we may not get the skill set we want or exact match, maybe a little band there. So where do we stand when we talk about meritocracy versus representation? A quick poll there. Can we have the next question, please? The next poll, please. Yeah. Should we focus on representation or should it be absolutely on the basis of meritocracy only? I know both of them are like a little gray zones. It's not absolutely one way or the other. Thank you. And the next question is about, the next poll is about, again, from a representation extension, when we talk about a quota, let's have a certain quota at the workplace because we are all number-driven people. When we have a target, we know how to achieve it. And, right? Am I talking to people awake? So when we have a quota, we have a target, we hit that number. Where do you stand when we talk about quotas at the workplace? Okay, thank you for that. So this is where I asked Drew, what is the challenge when we have a quota target? Like when you are X percent of an employee of a certain minority.
Yeah, the results are very interesting. So, and especially when you think of the previous question where we asked for majority still saying meritocracy comes first. So I think this question, I think we cannot generalize. Like, you know, quota for what? For what kind of representation? So, and it depends upon the kind of diversity, the right intersectionality that we are talking about. We had this amazing talk before that, and that's where this quota becomes a numbers game and becomes problematic in my point of view. So, but for some organizations who are driven by, like I know, like I work for a Chinese company, so they do like targets, they do like something that's written, it's a policy, and then all organizations work towards it, right? So in some cases it might work, so I'm never gonna say that it's a bad thing on its own. But at the other end, if I am that employee who's, who knows that I belong to a particular quota and I'm hired in this company as a diversity hire, I don't think so I like that. And that could be just my personal feeling, like, you know, but the other person could be that I don't get an opportunity at all, and at least I'm getting an opportunity because there is a quota for the first time. Maybe if I was trans, I would be asking for that, because I know that I don't have an opportunity if I don't have a quota. So this is a very complicated question in my point of view, and we can't just answer in a simple poll, I think. Like, you know, this is a very big conversation to have. But I personally feel the best way is when the organization itself asks for diversity. For instance, if within your organization you are having a board meeting, you are having a panel, and if you see every member of that belonging to the same group, they're all men, I think the organization themselves should scream that, oh, something is going wrong here. I have an award function, and every in my tech organization, and every awardee is a man. Something has gone wrong there again. That either we are not working towards women or other minorities are not getting the right opportunity. Why are only men succeeding? That doesn't happen. There's something going wrong there. So when it's organic, within the organization, people scream, something is going wrong. I'm not seeing diversity. That's where it works. Think of Oscar so white. There was no quota. There was nothing that, okay, black people need to get this many awards. But when people saw that this is not right, this can't be the way the world function, and people ask for it, and we saw change. So that's where I think there is a more chance of success than a simple quota. Thank you.
So, Vishwas, what do you think would the reaction of a certain majority population be if we try to put in a quota kind of a system where, say, we have to have a certain percentage of a population which is of a certain URM? How would people react?
Yeah. Can you hear me? Yeah, awesome. So quota is something that I believe it's a far-fetched milestone for the industry. If you look at what is happening practically right now, we're struggling with even women level diversity at this point in time. So LGBT and other categories are not in the scene at this point in time. That is a practicality on the ground at this point in time. The other thing that we need to understand is basically where we want to ultimately get as an industry is we want to be an equal opportunity industry. Everybody needs to be an equal opportunity company. That is where it is important. The minute we introduce the quota, these days there are a lot of thoughts about, say, 20% diversity is required, and then 5% you want LGBT and stuff. These are great from the perspective of giving this charter to the senior leadership and saying that, okay, this is important, that you guys need to go after this. But the minute that you start opening it, make it strict at the grassroots level, and then you start taking people in these quotas, then suddenly you're diluting the meritocracy on the in the grassroots level. And this is, again, going to become what happened in the public sector, and you know what the situation is there right now. It's very messy, and things don't go forward. That's the problem. So anybody who comes on board has to come because of merit. That is no exception. But having said that, I think we need to have drives. We need to have awareness so that people are exposed to hiring diversity. It is such a world that we are staying in right now. I just the other day, I had written on LinkedIn, I was talking about, we are talking about diversity. I call myself as the male champion of diversity. I'm part of even the Lean in India's executive committee. I'm trying to see what best has to be done in the industry to make sure that women and minorities are represented. But other day on Jobs for Her, I think Jobs for Her was a forum, and this some random CEO of some company comes and comments, enough of all this women empowerment crap. This is what he writes. They're meant to cook, clean, give birth, and raise kids. So stop talking about all this. He's writing on LinkedIn. He's CEO of some company. And people are shocked. So I wrote about it. I spoke about it in front of everybody. You can even check my LinkedIn. I write every day on LinkedIn, and a lot of people commented on it. This guy is like, no matter how much we are trying to talk to him, make him understand, because I was trying to be very, very nice to him, trying to understand, okay, what is the problem? Why are you feeling like this? is very unapologetic. He really feels that women shouldn't be there in the workplace. So now forget about LGBT. We are still struggling at women level at this point in time. So we have a long way to go. And somebody in that comment, somebody is writing, I feel pity on his mother. Somebody's writing. So I wanted to write, pity is not because of mother. The mother is a culprit. Mother should have taught him how to behave with other women, how to be inclusive in the thought process. If we don't correct our children, they'll ultimately go and become like that. That is a problem we are facing right now.
So while the opinion on quota is very interesting and very divided, it definitely does give a foot in the door for people who may have not have a chance to go and work. And a lot of people also create their career and build their identity and show their skill set after getting a chance. Because a lot many times, you're just not allowed in the door, right? In this particular example, let's say a lot of trans people who may not necessarily have the necessary degrees which are needed as a preliminary interview cut, but they have skill set. And more we talk about the gig economy, more freelance, and more skill sets which are very niche, which you can learn in a non-educational setup also. And you have an opportunity to deliver, but it's just that you never get a chance to do that, right? So it's very interesting and nuanced based on what we're talking about. There are two sides of the same coin. So I move to the next question of dissent and D&I. Do we have enough space to dissent and say we do not agree with it or this is wrong? Or is there too much political correctness in the workplace? And you must be aware of the Google employee who was fired. How many of you are aware of it? Raise your hand, please. Thank you. Okay, people who are not aware, just quickly Google it and read about it. So where do people stand on this particular case? Strongly disagree, neutral? Disagree? This is anonymous, so your names are not coming up, so you can actually say what you feel. Okay. So a lot more people stand on neutrality and disagreement compared to agreement. So can we have the next poll question, please? Next poll, please. How many of you actually read that memo? Okay, this poll, please, only people who answered the previous poll, only they answer this, right? Because if you haven't heard about it, there's no point you filling in this. So why I asked this question and why we wanted to know this is because a lot many times we are so much moved by the perception and the narrative and we want to be part of that narrative. Someone is labeled as anti-diversity and then we say, okay, has to be blamed, has to be shamed, and has to be punished for that. Very few instances we actually try to figure out what exactly happened, what was he saying, because what is said and what is not said, and how it is interpreted, how it is translated, a lot of that comes into play. So how many times we actually, and this is just one example case, this must be happening in your organizations also, where people say something and it is maybe extrapolated, maybe not, misinterpreted, maybe the intent is not wrong. Do we look at those and do we feel that people feel that we just can't say anything which is not the main narrative of the company? Do people feel that? A quick raise of hands. No? How many feel that you have space for dissent? Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you feel there is no space for dissent? Raise your hand. Okay, so what is the majority thinking? We're not going to make an opinion on this. Yeah, because only a few hands went when they say we don't have space for dissent, and few went for we have a space for dissent, but the rest of them did not raise their hands. So either you have or you don't have, or is it too binary? So the question is, how do we engage with dissent? Because dissent is a very important point in a conversation. Only if we engage with dissent do we learn about a certain other perspective, which may not be our perspective. Because D&I is all about realities of other people, which is not our experience, right? What if I've never met an LGBT person, they don't exist in my world, right? If I've never seen a woman who is working, my assumption is they don't deserve a place at the workplace. So my reality is this, and people come with different realities at the workplace. And when we talk about meritocracy and we look at skill set, what all comprises that skill set in the list of meritocracy, that also needs to be looked at, right? When you talk about managerial and people skills, it's not just the degrees of whatever degrees you have, but also what skill set you bring along with the experience of working with different set of people. So the next question is, so organizations are built on assumptions, right? This is what my target population is. I know what women want, and hence I'm going to make this. Maybe I'm an all-man team, or maybe I'm an all-woman team, and I know what men want, and I'll make this product, right? Does that happen, right? Am I talking to whom? Come on, people, some response. I know you had lunch. Yes? So workplaces are based on assumptions. Do we agree with that? Yes? An assumption of how a typical employee would look like, these are the number of hours they will work, these are the various food pack choices they should have, and things like that. Every single thing we assume, right? From the size of the bathrooms in the workplace, the size of cubicle, the size of the number of breaks, and every single thing is based on assumptions. And when an assumption is based on my identity, it may not be reflective of every employee who can be a potential employee. It may also not be reflective of every person who could be a market for me, right? So when we look at those assumptions, and we have someone who is a URM, who is a different, right? So the question for you, Deepa, is that if I'm in a URM in a workplace, I'm different from the rest crowd, that is maybe the only male in an all-woman team or only female in an all-men team, should I fit in or should I stick out? Should I be myself and stand for who I am and be myself and then try to fit in the team, or should I just try to meld in? Because once I join a new team, my acceptance for the team is also very important, that people accept me and treat me and share every single thing, like the knowledge and everything. So should you stick out or should you fit in?
So for me, I think it's very important to stick out in terms of inclusion. So, you know, the matter of fact that you bring your whole sim within the organization is to be who you are. So the more you're going to go undercover, the more it's going to get very difficult for you to be included and for the team members to get you into the team, right? So I think to stick out is very important. And I was just sharing, Graham, some of the examples of how we kind of, you know, ask team members to be a little vocal about what is that they require. Right, it could be in terms of their technology that they want to use. Is it, you know, their inclusion with just going out with a team member, right, for like say dinners or lunches? You know, you have to stick out to be ensuring that you are included. I think your voice to stick out is very critical, right? And you know, I think that's where we kind of add more value to inclusion, right? So the more closet, the more we go into the closet, I think it's going to be very difficult. So having an open conversation with your team members or your bosses, I think is very important for you to play an equal field within your team. So I think sticking out is important in terms of your team understanding you and you including yourself within the team.
But when you stick out, don't you risk like not getting included in the whole team because they have a set culture and people would assume that you're just not a culture fit? Does that become a challenge?
So for me, sticking out is not to be, you know, seen as too horned, like, you know, okay, you're becoming gruesome for your team to actually adhere to your thing. It's more about including yourself within the team, right? Sticking out could be more of how you put yourself within a team of collaboration. Right, so I don't think that should be seen that way. In case of that, there should be clarification of why or how you're seen as completely a different person, right? So stronger examples when it comes to, say, people with disability or people with LGBT, it looks like they are sticking out, right? It looks like they're asking for more, but sometimes it's more about them including within the team, right? And I could bring an example where, you know, one of our team members, you know, wanted to ensure that whenever they are going out for an outing, she recommended the team that they call the venue to ask if everything was accessible, right? I think it was very critical for the team member to be included, right? And I think it sounded like a little more than what a boss would ask the EA to do, but it was very much for her to be included. So I think sticking out, as I said, has to come from a point of inclusion and how they get dealt within the team.
When you talk of sticking out, I'll come to you, Dhruv. You stick out like a sore thumb in the workplace, I assume, right? So he is not a D&I professional. This is his first D&I conference. And this is how he goes to work, and he's a purely tech job. So how has that been for you? Like, when you see a room full of people in pant shirt and hair, all, you know what a typical look it is, and then you go out there. So how is your interaction with client, with your team, and how has it impacted your career?
So firstly, I've been lucky that in an organization, we didn't have a dress code. So I kind of took it to the extreme and still stretching it to how far I can
have a dress code.
And then, like, you know, my personal opinion in general with clothes and other things, because I don't think clothes have gender in sense that you should wear what you want to wear, what looks good on you, and does it sparks joy, as Marie Kondo says, and if you look good, and that's fine. And at the same time, I am in a workplace where how I look has nothing to do with what work I do. And some places, people are not that lucky. Like, you know, you sometimes have to dress in a particular way, and that's completely fine. I'm not against it. But in a workplace where how I code or how I do my tech things has nothing to do with what I'm wearing or other ways as well. But regarding sticking out, I think we talked about lack of awareness as one of the main reasons, like, you know, the D&I is suffering. And I walk in the room, there is no lack of awareness. At least people talk about something, good or bad. Both are equally good. Not talking is the worst that can happen. Within the LGBT community, we are like a minority where there is a thing that, oh, you can actually hide and you can mingle. That's not true with all other diversity. You can't change the color of your skin, you can't change your gender, you can't change your gender identity. But yes, if I want to fit in, I have a choice of fitting in, right? But I refuse to. And that's the stand that I take. Not everybody does that. And it's completely fine. It's individual choice when it comes to that. But the one thing which I always do is, when I'm sticking out, I'm still a part of a team. And when it comes to the job that I do, which has nothing to do with my sexuality at all, that's not impacting. So I'm a part of a team. And inside the team, when it comes to how I look, has nothing to do with the job that I'm doing, and the team understands it. And it's not up for conversation. So I have to do that. Like, you know, I don't expect anybody to come and comment on it. And you go with that professional outlook to other people. And at least in my case, I've seen that other people do respond to that. When you go with this no bullshit demeanor at work, that this is who I am, take me for what it is, this is not up for conversation. And that works. People respect that.
But did you have ever any issue where you were asked to tone down or something like that?
In my long journey, I came out while I was inside this organization, and it's been a progression. And maybe that helps. Maybe giving people, not shocking them in one go and just going step by step in the last 15 years that I've been in this organization has helped. And now people come to me within my organizations, talk to me about it. And I still say, like, you know, everybody's journey is different. I also say you don't have to come out at work if you're not comfortable with it. Do it on your own terms. For me, it was that I had to. I had no other choice. When you don't, you come out when you have no other choice, because this is something that's hampering who you are, and you are not being the best version of yourself. But if you're not comfortable, not everybody could be. And if in your professional career you need to keep that part hidden, do it. There's no shame in it. But if you have the opportunity, if you are in the leadership role and you realize that, yes, I am the lucky one who can be out to the world, then be out, become, like, you know, inspire other people who do not have the same privilege that you have. Acknowledge that.
So when we talk about URM from an identity perspective, let's say LGBT, gender, PWD, the disparity of the workplace, the discrimination we face at the workplace is a reflection of the society we live in. Do we agree with that? Yes? It's what we are raised to think, what we align and we feel is true. We behave the same way at the workplace. But then should the workplace be, and this is Vishwas, this is for you, should workplace be the place for social justice? Today we're talking about, let's say, gender, LGBT, and PWD. Tomorrow we may start talking about religion, region, caste. Now, am I here to work or talk about all these kinds of things? Is social justice a workplace responsibility?
Yeah, the thing is that knowingly or unknowingly, the workplace is a place that brings everybody on a level playing field. That is the good thing about it. Because what really happens in society, if you look at it, the LGBT or all the minority, the class that we are talking about at this point in time, they need to be economically earning. And they need, when they earn, when they're standing on their own feet, then that means that they have the societal respect. They can live their livelihood. They don't have to depend on anybody else, because financial independence is the key for success of this entire program that we're trying to do, the D&I, and ultimately that's what it leads to. So now to do that, the corporate sector is, I think, the place that is actually making it happen, because people are coming in and they're earning and then they are equal to anybody else out there at this point in time. So I feel that knowingly or unknowingly, that is happening altogether at this point in time. But what needs to happen is that everybody has to get in through merit. That is, again, I'm trying to bring that point, because ultimately, end of the day, it has to be on merit. But how do you make sure that people are coming on merit, even through the LGBT community and everything? That can only happen if, from the birth, they have been given equal opportunity for education, for healthcare, for everything else out there. The awareness is there. They feel included from the day one. So that is important. So it is like a cycle. So we need to make sure that this cycle is going and it increases. So that is something that the industry has to take care of and be a very, very much a level playing field and bring justice to everybody.
Deepa, can we have your thoughts on this? Like, should workplace be the place of social justice?
You know, I think it is a reflection, and I think we should have social justice because somewhere down the lane, we all are back to our homes and we reflect back again back to the organization. I think, like Vishwas just mentioned, it should be a norm where, you know, we kind of give justice to all minorities, especially the minority groups in India. You know, it's, you know, with the lack of representation, right, even today, you know, we have a lot of way to go ahead in making this, more inclusive, you know, across. So I think we should invest more and more on social justice. Yes.
My opinion here would be that yes, we should have social justice, but we should not be social justice warriors at That's work, true. Where it needs to be like, you know, the complete, like with a mission. We are at least maybe belonging to a particular minority, my main job at work is to actually do the work. And that should take priority. And these things comes next. And even there, I think it's a journey. And we should respect that journey. In the sense that, for instance, within my work, if somebody would say to me, oh, I'm fine that, like, you know, oh, you, that with all the LGBT thing, but I don't think so, you should adopt. India is not there. And for me to just shut him down and, like, you know, give him a whole lecture on how that's there, I should not do that. I do that in a, at least he is not homophobic, he's talking to me, it's a conversation. So we should welcome those conversations, and especially in the world of social media and this, we just shut people down. Moment somebody says something which doesn't feels right to us, we don't want to have those conversations. And I feel social media is not the place to have those conversations. One-to-one is the place to have conversation. And let people come to you, and as we talked about dissent, saying that, yes, I don't agree with everything that you say. And this is not just in D&I. We talk about politics. We work in an organization where our political views would be completely different with our team members. But we work. We belong to the same team. We work together, and there is a space for having different opinions. And I feel in some respect, the same thing should be true here. There should not be any negativity. There should be respect. But it should be allowed to deviate from somebody else's point of view. And that's completely fine.
So in the same line, another question for you is that with inclusion, there is expectation of change. The way things are, that changes. Maybe the dynamics of the population changes or the requirements of the language changes. Let's say like an LGBT scenario, when you talk about instead of husband and wife, now we use the term partner and spouse. Now there's a thing about GNC, which is gender non-conforming, non-binary genders, and gender fluidity. We have the pronoun they. Is it too much to ask for people to change the language to be inclusive? So basically the question is around difference of the space for you to be yourself and the space of culture fit. Where is the balance?
I feel like, you know, this is a something that's like, you know, it's the next thing in D&I, if you ask me, that all you leaders who are here needs to be ready for this. This is coming. And when it comes to pronoun, I respond to all of them, so it's kind of easy for me. And I'm he, she, they, I don't care, because gender is stupid. And which is completely fine. So there are people with multiple identities, and they will, when they feel comfortable within their workspace, they'll talk about it. And for, if they ask me, I'll say, talk to your immediate team members first. Those are the people that you work with. An HR department sits far away. Their policies are not going to impact you on the day one. What impacts you is the close team that you interact with. And based on that team environment, find allies within that team, be comfortable with them, share what you, how you want to be responded with. And give them something that you are not asking them for something big. You work in a multicultural environment. You learn about different cultures. You learn about how to respect a Japanese person and how to shake hands with a different culture or not to shake hands from a woman of a different culture. You learn those things. This is exactly like that. You are learning a new culture. You did not belong to it, but when somebody sits you down and tells, this is how I would like you to respect me, we should be open to it. And once you have those conversations with people who are open, this might happen. But once you set a policy that everybody in their email signature should put their preferred pronouns and everybody in the email needs to follow that, that's gonna just open a can of worms. So it's not good for even the people who wants to be, because we don't want, we want comfort at work. We want to be included. We want like, you know, a space to succeed and equal opportunity, not special treatment. And with respect to, what was the other question? Lost my thought.
Deepa, talking about reasonable accommodation, when as a workplace, we do certain accommodation for, let's say, a URM, let's say, the PWD population. Could you share some instances where something which was targeted for a population, but it, at the end, everyone uses that and it benefits everyone?
You know, a couple of examples is, you know, when you make parkings, which is for people with disabilities, right, car parkings. We also included people who are, like, women who are pregnant, right? It's right next to the lift. So these, you know, kind of created a lot of awareness. Likewise, when we created sign language interpreters across the organization that, you know, we should have interpreters in, say, town halls, right? It kind of gave a lot of awareness. And these were actually built for, say, you know, set of group of people who needed that interpretation, right? So, but we did take a call to make it like a norm that the complete organization adopts interpretation in town halls, right? This kind of enabled people to understand sign language, a lot of awareness around it. So people take it ahead and make it a norm, even to make it accessible during their meetings, right? So I think when you create inclusion, when you're creating accommodation and inclusion, it kind of, you know, acts as a bold, you know, messaging across the organization. When you create like something like a gender-neutral washroom, I think, you know, it kind of gives a very strong message that we don't see in public spaces. Right? This was a conversation that we are having to have gender, you know, neutral washrooms. And the question was asked, we don't see it in India. We don't see it in, say, you know, any of the public spaces, like malls or anything like that, right? But the idea is we are progressing, right? We are progressing in the space. The more we kind of drive or lead, it's going to enable others. So I feel the more, you know, that we drive in terms of accommodation or building more of inclusion within the organization, that's enabled others also to feel that they are included, right? So for example, you know, when we get softwares for people with visual impairment, right? On the go, today IT has said that anyone who's going to hire a visually impaired, we're going to ensure the software is by the digital and not by the business, right? The IT is going to sponsor it, right? So we kind of made it more inclusive across the pillars of the organization. So accommodation somewhere shows a very strong culture of inclusion, builds empathy within the organization, I would say, and strong awareness as well.
So one of the other things, like when we do an accommodation for a certain population, other employees in the organization feel they also have a voice, and if they have a reason to ask for something, they will be heard too. So while we have a certain population target initiative, it shows that the organization cares, and whatever my needs are, I can ask for them. Do you, any of you, have a story like that you want to share? Like something which was done for a certain targeted population, but it helped everyone? Nope. Anyone wants to share? Okay. So Vishwas, the question for you is D&I a MNC thing? Is it only for large corporations to think about D&I, or you work with startups a lot? How does it function there?
Yeah, so I work with a lot of startups. I'm running a couple of startups myself. And startups don't have time for D&I. Most of them, there's no awareness of it. And I believe it's not that it is a bad thing for startups, at least, because the culture is so inclusive there by default. There, it's all about getting things done. You're trying to go chase a vision, trying to get things done on a day-to-day basis. It's about hustle every day. So anybody who is passionate, who wants to roll up their sleeves and get their hands dirty and get things going, no matter who you are, the startup world is going to welcome you. That is the best part about the startup culture. They open their arms and they welcome you, and then you are able to contribute 110%, you're there. And then on the go, you make the policies, on the go, you do it, because in startup world, it's not like you waiting for somebody to put together like a D&I kind of a charter and all of that. In startup world, you go there, you do it yourself. That's how it is, because that's the kind of leadership that you need to take, right? So that's amazing thing I feel about what startups have done. I believe I have seen a lot of people from the LGBT, the community and all of that. So it's really thriving out there. I think it's the right kind of a model. Even for the large organizations, they could really follow that whole thing. But I understand that for large organizations, you need a different kind of systems and all of that.
Any questions in the audience? We can now take the questions if you have on Slido. Or if anyone wants to raise their hand and ask a question. No questions. Wow. Yeah, ask.
You do disagree? Yeah. You can tell me. Yeah.
My sense is that the VC networks are extremely male, technology, engineering college, IIM included factors.
Yeah.
Don't look at diversity, even though for me the startup is the world that should actually allow us opportunities to be more inclusive, because we have more LGBTs on campuses than we see in corporates. So I just wonder whether we see that.
It's a fantastic point. So I think you're right and you're wrong, both. I'll tell you why. Because what happens is the VCs are not the startup people. So VCs always... there is a bias towards males, okay? I mean, the thing is, they fund men. That's what they do. Men-driven companies are like 95% VC funds go to them, because for various reasons that happens. That is the problem. So if you look at how many VCs really, really fund, you know, women-led companies, it is like minority kind of a situation. Now, what I was trying to talk was from the perspective of employees, you know, where you are looking at going and working somewhere and all of that. So there, it's not there as such. Okay, so there are only a few startups where, you know, they're IT driven. And why usually it happens that, you know, ultimately there are men going into the tech sector is because, you know, it's you know it already. I've been trying to focus on it and do it. There are many reasons for it. Number one, many women, they drop out after their wedding, the marriage, they stop, and then after their they give birth, they stop. Worse, I will tell you the situation. So whenever whoever comes to me, I interview a lot of people, I'd like to interview them, I ask them, why are you shifting to Bangalore when I'm hiring a lot of women? They always tell me that I just came to Bangalore because my husband got transferred to Bangalore, so I came to Bangalore. It took me like 5 to 10 years to find somebody, a man, who told me that, okay, I got transferred to Bangalore because my wife got transferred. So that shows you how the situation is in the market. For women, by default means that career is secondary, by default. So now you tell me how the VCs are going to put money. They'll not put money because you yourself, women themselves are not making the career primary. Then how the VCs will put money on them? So that, I'm just trying to tell you that women have to take control themselves. That is where it has to start. And the same thing with the LGBT also. They have to take control. This kind of an the event here, this is what we need because this is awareness. This is telling people that no, you can also do it. You're not inferior to anybody. You can do it just like anybody else. So that is what is important. And I thank you so much for bringing up this topic. I hope that I made it clear.
So last 1 minute, if you have any questions. Okay, we have discussed about obvious diversities. How do we make a case about the not so spoken ones, namely ideas, thoughts, traits, regional, national diversity? Who wants to answer that? We have discussed about obvious diversities, basically the visible ones. How do we make a case about the not so spoken ones, namely about diversity of ideas, thoughts, traits, regional or national diversity? You want to take it?
So whenever we create teams anywhere, it's always important that you look at diversity. You know, diversity is not only in terms of gender or whatever, it's in terms of thoughts from which place you're coming from and all of that. So a company that has an open culture always creates this kind of a teams. These are called cross-functional teams that are required to create something out of the box. That is very important. So whenever we want to create any out of the box thinking, we always look at cross-pollination of ideas. So people who come from different sectors and trying to disrupt certain business processes and all of those stuff. If you look at all the people who have really disrupted something, that there has been a cross-pollination. If you look at Zomato or Paytm or any other thing you're looking at right now, these people were not there from the food industry. They were from a tech industry. They came to food and they tried to look at, okay, how do we disrupt this market? So I believe that diversity of thought is very, very important, and I believe that national integration and diversity, all that plays a part in that.
I think one important way of enabling the diversity of thoughts is allowing people to freely express what they feel. It could be tech ideas, it could be product ideas, which you're not really sure will work. It's the risk appetite of the organization to let people run with the program and see how it goes. I mean, the more opportunities we create, people have for people to do something, automatically, people who like that idea from whichever sector they are, whatever thoughts they have, they will be attracted to it because they feel like there's an opportunity to do something and deliver something. So that's my point on it. Any more questions? If not, then that's the end of it. Thank you so much for being a lovely audience. And hope we covered some of your dilemmas. And if you have more questions, we're available around. Thank you so much.